Are appreciating banaba kaba utswanelwa. Letu ele jealous downi. Jealous downi abolaisha. Ikosa chaba tumatimone amangata. Bazame hape man. Upela wula lima keluane. Mujur karata hairstyle ewe ya kao. Hele makeup ona sabulela ko rata waya waya. Maybe Mujur you are blessed to sit next to me. Because you are seated next to a powerhouse. I know that you don't look like a powerhouse, but you are. Amen. Because challenge ya motho ke go lebella motho based on how he looks now. A lebala hore God is at work. And when God is finished with his products, you will be shocked. Amen. Murutis mono le mama, thank you very much for allowing us to be here. And thank you for the great work that you're doing this side. This is one of the greatest work of our brothers that we know. Oh, oh, oh. That's all that. Even when you tell them that they are great, they find it difficult to receive. Because we were never told we are great. We tell each other how great they are when other people do not hear what we are saying. That's how black people are. That's how black people are. If you don't have food, they don't come and give you food. But if you die, they bring food. They don't talk about you when you are alive. If you die, they start talking about you. Now we are at the feet, one of the greatest conference in Gauteng. We are saying nothing. Wait until Muruti Simone is no more. That's why I don't want people to take pictures with me. Because others are just taking pictures with you so that the day you die, they show people or they want to get a picture with you. Because they take pictures, they don't put those pictures now when you are still alive and tell people, I've met a great man, Batum. They wait until you die and say, we were rubbing shoulders with big people. Null entries, like a sharp. We celebrate you, Baba. We celebrate you. We love what the Lord is doing. And we greet all pastors that are here. Thank you for supporting one of your own. Amen. One of the things that we must learn to do is to be inspired and have the ability to manage inspiration. Because when inspiration is not well managed, it can develop into jealousy and envy. Yes. That's why we must manage inspiration correctly. We must not be inspired and say, I wish it was me. We must be inspired and say, fly and be the best version of yourself. Amen. There's one thing, Murutis Mona, that I love about seats. Seats do not compete. Even if you saw them next to each other, you will never find a day where a particular seat tried to be something else that it is not. All seeds, when they germinate to produce what is naturally in them. If this seed is meant to be under the ground for 3 weeks, it will stay there. Because it knows that if I can just come out fast, I will not survive. So the best thing about you is not when you try to be somebody. The best thing about you is when you are yourself. Because when you are yourself, you've got no reason to compete with any man. Amen. My wife is here with me, 21 years. Amen. Amen. So, le never let claim our leansevali. You can focus. This is the person who knows me better. When you know the man on the pulpit, he knows both the man on the pulpit and the man somewhere. Amen. Hallelujah. Can we also appreciate our kids? I saw some of our kids around. Can they just stand and let's appreciate them? All kids from the Wisdom Center. Thank you for coming and thank you for being here. Amen. 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 Bless the Lord. Amen. I'm the third speaker. And when you are the third speaker, you are always in between. You are not sure as whether you must start a new thing or you must go back and cover the space. Amen. Because we must let you look. My shady are the speakers. So raise a vana, ya ba my shady. Because when they are first speakers, they clear everything. So you act like Ruth now, you must look for leftovers. And at times there is nothing to glean. Murutimake? Murutisma? Skardia so. Marotlo leka mudimuko mubots. Amen. What a word you ministered last night. And it's very powerful sense because what falls on the table, Murutimaki, has got all the particles of what is on the table. So when it falls from the table, it does not lose the quality or the ingredients that is on the table. So what is on the floor went through the process of what is on the table. So the truth is, we are eating the same thing, but on different positions. Amen. But today I want to speak to you shortly. What's the time? Now 4 minutes past eight. You could tell a little time, ka 10 to 9. Linke mish. Ngastro moye. Kipela gele moye. So I get an engagement. So if time is up, let me know. Indicate for me. I tell you. Saints, I want to talk to you about this subject that says, live by your design. Live by your design. Maybe look at your neighbor and say, live by your design. Because one of the things, saints, that you do at the feet of Jesus is to find the real you, is to find your assignment. Because most of us, we become super that haven't mastered themselves. We've got people that are out in the marketplace but who do not know who they really are. Because one of the questions that we must forever ask ourselves and be able to answer is, who am I? Because that's the question of identity. Not what do I have? Which means that the first prayer point of your life must never be, God, give me something. It must be saying, God, who am I? Because once you know who you are, you are able to identify what should be yours. Because it's not everything that is out there that is yours. Even the ones that you are claiming, it's not everything that is out there that is yours. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Because what you need, it is what will enhance the assignment that you carry, that you came here for. So once we are able to answer the question of who am I, we have managed to answer one of the critical questions in life. The next question is, where am I coming from? Which is my heritage. What is it that I'm here for? What am I here to push as an agenda or as an assignment? Because you must understand that, as I normally say, when God does a thing, he does it generationally so. So meaning that I'm not just starting a thing. I'm continuing with a thing that has already started. So I need to be able to say, where am I coming from? Because it is therefore where I come from that also give me a direction of where I'm going. So the clarity of knowing where am I coming from gives me a standpoint of saying, where am I now? And that's why at times we say you must learn to deal with your past. Because when we say, where are you coming from? We are saying, your life does not start with man. Your life started with God. So therefore, you must go as far as when God started the journey of your life, so that what man does or what man did in your life does not frustrate what God is doing in your life. All right? So the question of saying, why am I here, is the question of purpose. What is my assignment? Am I here ukapaba tugeba pila na? Am I here to do what people are doing? Am I here to copy the latest trends of life? Or I've got a specific assignment that is able to isolate me from others and make me unique? And that's why we've got a tendency of people that are afraid to be unique. And I'm saying, if you are afraid to be unique, you will never be the best version of yourself. Even when you do the same thing, but you need to do it with your uniqueness, because your power, your real power, your real effectiveness is hidden in your uniqueness. All right? That's why even as preachers, ngasirere utswanelletswa. Where my mapleke ya twa kwa ya kwa twa. Nenga dira what he is doing, kitlotsa mama otwa ka fish. All right? So I am comfortable katsela ya ka udi alotsa ka slow. Whether you're saying I'm not powerful, none of your business. Because if we're not powerful, that's your own case to deal with. So when you embrace your uniqueness, because people want you. Because the moment we see you becoming something that looks like Letswalo, we get irritated. Because we forever say, come on, be yourself. We are here, gathered here for you. Because if we wanted Muruti Letswalo, we will go to Great Harvest called Juju Vale. So we cannot come here and see you. All right? So when we say we are at the feet of Jesus, we are also saying we are finding who we are in God. So that we become impactful and effective out there. Because that's why we are here. So the next question is, what can I do in this life? Is the question of, am I having some potential? And gifted, we are, all of us. I'm saying gifted, we are, all of us. But unfortunately, is that life has forced us to gauge or categorize our giftings. And that's the reason we celebrate people the day they match the standard that we have assumed to be saying, this is the greatest thing. And that's why as pastors, I also know that most of the powerful people in this life, they've never been on the pulpit. They've never been here. Most of the powerful people that are carrying the visions of the church, they've never been here. But they are not known. They are not celebrated. Because we're thinking, well, for you to be effective, you must have a particular platform to operate from. And I'm saying to you, there are different platforms. When we start to fight over one platform, we are killing what God is trying to do. Where am I going? That's the next question. It's a question of destiny. Where will be my end? So when you bring these questions, all of them in one basket, if you are able to answer them accurately, so I tell you, no devil will stop you from doing what God has called you to do. But if you fail to articulate them correctly, you will go in the midst of people and they will influence you and influence you every day. And that's why most of you, 1 year you are high, 1 year you are down, 1 year you are very hot and you are vibrating, you feel the presence of God. 1 day you don't feel the presence of God. It's because you don't understand that you don't have to learn situations. You must learn you and then connect yourself to God. And therefore God does not become a church thing, it becomes a friendship thing that you have with him every day of your life. And that's why when you get to that point, you don't come to God to, or don't come to church to worship, you come to church because you are a worshiper. And therefore you don't come here and wait for people to pamper you with some music and some things for you to tap in, because already you will come knowing who you worship. And that's why in our days, we've got a very powerful church on a Sunday morning, but a very weak church on a Monday morning. Because we haven't learned to have a relationship with the God that we claiming to be serving. We know how to relate with church members. That makes us feel powerful. But we have never made a conscious decision of connecting with God to a point that we feel him every moment and every day of our lives. I was telling our church this thing on Sunday to say, under average, I'm changing the story. Under average, if you were to come to church every day or every Sunday over a year, if our church starts by 9 and ends at about 11, it means that you've got about 3 hours every day. So if you've got 3 hours every day in a period of 52 weeks, you've got about 156 hours. And if you were to divide 156 hours by 24, you will have 6.5 days. Which means that if you've got an experience with God only on a church day, it means that out of 365 days, you only have 6.5 days of relationship with God. And that relationship will not make you effective in your life. Because there are some demons, there are some powers that need somebody who knows how to have an intense relationship with God. Your 6.5 days is not enough. And that's why if you are complaining about church, I wonder, what are you doing at home? Because you have noticed that you don't even have time with God on your own. And therefore it means that if you don't come to church, we were to reduce and cut 3 hours, and most of you were left with only 1 day of fellowship and intense relationship with God over a year. And how can we be effective when time has not been invested in God? So I want you to understand that once you understand your design, you will then understand, or what does it take for me to fulfill the assignment of this design? Can I give an example? If I was to bring a scissor, Philip Page. If I was to bring a scissor and a razor blade and a knife and an axe, all of them they are used to cut. Go back. All of them are used to cut. Do we agree? But if you don't understand that it is meant to cut what, then you misuse the design that is built in this equipment. If you are to cut papers, Therefore, you must go and search for a particular instrument designed to cut these things. Because if you bring an axe, you are not cutting, you are destroying. So until you understand your design, you will intervene in spaces where you are thinking we are just cutting, whereas we are not just cutting, we are dependent on a particular instrument that is able to cut what we are working on. And that's why most of us, we are doing some things and we don't see results, because what we are using is not designed to do what we want to do. Though a knife can cut here, but it will not cut nicely. So the reason our churches are not matching up what God is really wanting to do in our generation is because we are trying to be an instrument that we saw it working effectively there, and we are not careful of what we are doing in hope restoration. If in Cornerstone we are using an axe to cut, it does not mean that in each and every church we must use an axe to cut. And that's why it's important to find your design. It's important to find your shape and understand your shape. Once you grasp that, maybe I must say like preachers of old, no devil will stand against you. No, his mother-in-law will be able to stand with you. But the truth is, you need to understand your design. Because you function well when you have understood your design. You get tired easily when you work out of your design. You get frustrated easily when you work out of your design. You get irritated easily when you work out of your design. You lose passion easily when you work out of your design. You get bland easily when you work out of your design. So I'm going to pick up a story of a young man that we all know. And I'm going to try to flow with this man. His name is David. Look at your neighbor and say, David. I'm going to read a verse. Please, this verse that I'm going to read, please, you must not allow it to frustrate you. It's a simple verse, but it can be complicated if you look it wrongly. 1 Samuel chapter number 17. From verse number 38. That's where we are starting. We're reading just 38 to 40. And Saul armed David with his armor, and he put an helmet of brass upon his head, and also he armed him with a coat of mail. And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he assayed to go, for he had not proven it. He tried to go with it, because it was for the very first time he was trying it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with this. You are the king. You have given me something that has got labels of saying it has won some battles. I'm trying to go with it, king, but I can't. I'm going into what you used to go to with this. But this is not for me. I wish you will hear me tonight. I know you've got belts accomplished because of this armor. And this is one, according to the norm, must be taken to the battlefield. But please, O king, your armor is too expensive and royal, but it's irrelevant to me as David. Because if I use it, it will not give me the result it gave you, because I am not designed for it. Ooh. I am not designed for it. The helmet is good, but it's not good on me. The
sword is powerful, but it's not powerful on me. The shield is powerful, but not on me. I'm a kind of a person that goes to the battlefield with a sling and stones. If I go with your armor, I am defeated even before I go, because I can't even walk to start with. Instead of going to war, I'm still struggling. How am I going to walk? You have given me something that is too heavy for my giftings and my shapes. And that's why as a church, we must understand that we are not in here for We are not here for uniformity, but we are here for unity. And that's why if you are shaping yourself for uniformity, the church will not thrive the way it should, because we are just going to do the same thing over and over. For the church to be effective, we need somebody that will also go the other way and touch areas that we are not touching, and that's when we become effective as a church. So David is saying, I haven't proven it. And it was not an easy thing, Rutimake, to go to the king and tell him, what you claim to be powerful is not powerful enough. Though I am dealing with giants. The question is, Saul, if what you are giving me is powerful, why didn't you use it to fight Goliath? Why do you want me to trust what you did not trust? I'm going to show you what I trust. I trust the weakness of the world. I trust what the nation says is not working. Goliath will be surprised to see a young boy, first of all. Not just a young boy with a sling. And that's why Goliath was confused, and he said, do you think that I'm an animal or am I a bird? Because what you're bringing to me is strange for the battlefield. Maybe look at your neighbor and say, live by your design. Your design is made for what God wants to do through your life. Be happy with your design. The reason we've got designers who designs our clothes is because they work specifically with our body. I don't go and choose and fit. They come and measure me and find what design will suit me. The reason designers are more expensive, like what you just go and pick, is because it's specific and detailed to a person. You become cheap when you're not detailed to your specifications. The anointing will not fall on you heavily the way it should when you are not adhering to your specifications. Specifications are key in achieving what God wants to do through your life. So David says, I can't. So David put them off. Maybe tell your neighbor and say, take it off. What's Iba? Tell him again, attitude. Say, take it off. Some of you must take off the tradition, religious traditions. Somebody once told me, Maruchis Mono, I don't look like a pastor. God, how do pastors look? He tried to explain and define how pastors should look. This guy does not understand. I don't have to look like a pastor. I just have to look like me. Because when God created me, he created me. It's me functioning in the office of a pastor. It's not the pastor functioning in me. So, and he took his staff in his hand and clothes and chose himself 5 smooth stones out of the brook and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had, even in a scrip, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. But Tata Baha, because you are afraid to approach. It was not Goliath who approached David. It was David who approached Goliath. In the olden days, we will draw a line and say, you cross here, you will see flames. But there were those who will draw the line, but being afraid too, they will forever say, cross, we will see. If you find a coward this side and the other side, you will stay here the whole day because no one will dare to cross. But David is saying, let's see. Who is this one? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Who is this guy without a covenant with God? I'm using a sling and stones, but I'm not trusting in them. I'm trusting in the covenant I have with God. So when you see slings and stones, you're thinking about this armor. I'm enforcing the covenant to work for me. That's why David is saying, I come to you in the name of the Lord. Instead of saying, I come to you with a sling and stone, you say, I come to you in the name of the Lord. When he says, I come to you in the name of the Lord, he's simply saying, now, I want you to know, I'm approaching you, but I'm hiding behind God. You will think that you're fighting me, but it will not be me. I just show up in the battlefield. But I did not bring myself, I brought God. And let's see what you will do when you deal with God. Right? So don't forget that. So now, the first thing that you need to understand about this story, maybe let me give you a background of the life of David. Prophet Samuel is given an instruction by God to say, go to Jesse's house, anoint for me a king. By that time, Saul is still on the throne. Samuel is saying, this is confusing because Saul will kill me. But he went there. When he got there, he's saying, Jesse, we are going to make a sacrifice, but God has chosen a king within your children. And one of them must be anointed today. Abinadab, Shama, they come through. And Samuel is tempted to anoint one of them because they look like they deserve it. But they are not shaped to be the next king. So now Samuel, after the 7 brothers came through, he says, God cannot lie. There must be a king in this house. Jesse, tell us the truth. Are all of your sons here? And Jesse says, but there is another one. He is no name by now.
He does not look the part now. He does not look the part now.
Amen.
And Samuel says, go get him for me. And Samuel is careful to say to Jesse, we are not going to sit until he comes. We are going to start worshiping him until he comes, because he is the one. If we sit, we are going to disrespect him. We must stand and worship him until he comes. Some documentaries will tell you, or Samuel tried to pour oil on Abinadab and the brothers with an open lid, but the oil refused to flow. The oil refused to flow until a young boy came through who was like rejected by the parents that thought he is not supposed to be here. There is no way God can appoint that. Maybe I need to say to you what I normally say to people. There are people that do not look like it, but they are it. And that's why it's very important for you to walk with God through revelation.
Amen.
So that you will see people through the eye that God uses to look at them. Because some of the people that we are not seeing and recognizing, they are the ones that God has identified to be next online. Right? So therefore, you will need to have that revelation. If you are to live according to your design, you must have a true revelation of who you are. Not what people made you to become. Not what situation has made you to become. Not what your family background has made you to become. Because you must understand, when you are released on earth, the enemy... In most cases, saints, when we say the enemy has come to kill, to steal, and to destroy, the challenge about the enemy is that there are some things that he stole them before we were even born. And when we were born, if we are not taught right, we will not get back to what God has already initiated from the foundations of the earth to be part of the life that we should live. And that's why when we come to church every day, saints, and we receive in the word, the most powerful thing about the word is not to give us information and knowledge, but is to take us back to the original intent, so that we find what God has trusted in us before the fall. So that we are able to take back even what the enemy has stolen before we showed up. So we will need the revelation. Because you cannot live in your design if you don't have a true revelation of what God is about in your life. Because if you lack that revelation, we will give you identity. We will give you the shape. We will tell you what you cannot do and what you can do. And that's why most of us, we are shaped by the people that has raised us. We are shaped by the situations that we grew up in. And we are failing to hear the voice of God that says there is something unique about you. There is something that you have never visited about your life. Can I hear somebody saying amen? Because lack of revelation will frustrate you. And that's why one day Jesus tells his disciple and says, who do people say I am? And they said, some are saying you are one of the old prophets, Elijah. And he said, who do you say I am? And Peter says, you are the Son of the living God. You are Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, Peter, flesh and blood has not revealed that to you. Because it's possible to walk with yourself for years without even discovering what God is doing in your life. until you have a proper revelation about your life,
you will not walk in the dimension that God wants you to walk in. You will copy what others are doing and not do what you are made to do. So the truth is, once you understand your shape, you can be like Moses and walk around with a rod. Yeah. And people think it's a walking stick. Yeah. Whereas you know this is not a walking stick. Yeah. It's a thing that opens the Red Sea. Yeah. I use it to walk, but I'm waiting for a situation. Once there's a situation before me, you will see me pointing. That which I carry now can open ways where there are no ways. That which I'm carrying now can make a provision of water in the wilderness. That which I'm carrying now can make God to bring provision where there is dryness. But it's when you understand your shape, because your shape will inform you of what you carry. And that's why you must not allow people to lie to you and say you've got a big head. When they say your head is big, you must say, my head is big so that it can contain enough brain. Because what I'm working on needs a capacity nyana ya brain. Over. Because I cannot have a big head and have a smaller nyana quantity of brain. No. Then it becomes sickness. Maybe look at your neighbor and say, you need a revelation of yourself. The next thing that you need to do, that we're picking up at the life of David as he continues, is that he learns to eliminate some things in his life. Because if you are to live by your design, you must learn to cut off some things in your life. Because some of you are heavy and what you are carrying is not yours. And that's why it becomes like the armor of Saul. It's heavy on you. You can't walk because it's heavy. And it's an opportunity for us through this conference to realize there is some stuff that must be cut off of my life. Because until they are cut off, I can't be the shape that I'm supposed to be. I can't have the speed that I'm supposed to be running with. I can't have the accessibility to some things because the shape I'm carrying will refuse me entry to other doors. Maybe look at your neighbor and say, cut some stuff. Cut yourself from some attachments, man. There are some attachments that are not godly. There are some attachments that will delay and derail you. There are some attachments that will delay the process of God in your life. There are some attachments, until you cut them, you will never maximize the potential of God over your life. It's time to cut. Because some people, when you don't cut them, they pollute the atmosphere. They pollute the environment for your miracle. They pollute an environment for your breakthrough. And until you cut, let me help you. Let him help you. Some things are not happening, or some bad stuffs are happening in our life, not because we did not pray. They are happening because we did not cut people that caused them in the atmosphere that God has created for our lives. Look at your name and say, cut, man. Cut, cut. Because some of us, we are like people that are coming to our altars and say, Muruti, pray for me. I want God to bless me with a husband. But we really must chalisane. How? I did not want to go there. But cut. Look at your neighbor and say, cut. Yourself from everything that limit your speed. Cut yourself from anything that limit your progress. Cut yourself from anything that derails you and delay you. Cut yourself from anything that pollutes your mind. Because until you cut, you can be in the midst of assets and you still treat them like liabilities. Maybe I need to say this. Maybe it will help you. There are two groups of people that you must learn how to deal with them. If you don't learn how to deal with them, they will frustrate you. You've got people that are attached to us. But you also have people that are assigned to us. Those that are attached to us, they come to us because of what they gain from the relationship they have with us. That's why the day you no longer give out what you used to give to them, they leave. That's why you're forever crying and you're saying they used me and dumped me. It's because you relied too much on people that were attached to you, but that they were not assigned for you. But those that are assigned for you, I'm saying those that are assigned for you, they come into your life to make you the better version of yourself. They enjoy and celebrate you when you become a star. They clap their hands for you when you become the best version of yourself, because they are assigned for the assignment that God has given to you. And I'm here to say, stop crying for people that are attached in your life. Cut them off and look for people that are assigned for your assignment. But the challenge is this: people that are assigned to us, in most cases, they make us feel uncomfortable. If you're not careful, you will hate them, because they tell you the truth. When you're doing something stupid, they tell you it's stupid. They don't say it looks like, they say it is. So, So, in this conference, maybe if you can forget everything that I'm going to say or that I've already said, don't forget to go back and cut. Saints, Murutisma, challenge yarina. Correct times we don't know how to treat people. Because we're thinking that people that just have a bad day, they are just having a bad day. It's not that they have got a bad attitude, but we treat them the same. Peter failed many a times. As a pastor, you can look at Peter and say, I don't want you anymore in this church. Because you keep on failing. We keep on helping you. You're failing. You will embrace Judas. Because Judas has never failed. But he's got a very demonic heart. The day he shows up, he kills. He does not make mistakes. He kills. Cut people that are just attached in your life, but they are not assigned for your life. Remember, you are on the journey to become the king. And some of the people that you must really cut, they are your family members. Oh, I said it. You know why I'm saying this? It's because when the prodigal son comes back home, the father loves him, the brother hates him. And therefore the prodigal son on the other side is seeing the father throwing a party. On the other side, the brother is very angry. What do you do when the father loves you and the brother hates you? What do you do when the father throws the party, but your brother hates the party? He does not even enter the party room. Learn to cut. Learn to cut. Because if you don't learn to cut, you will rock around, you will preach around, you will sing around, you will usher around you, with a wrong shape. You will develop a sharp you will develop a sharp curve that is not nice. It hurts. It's a curve, but it causes accidents in the church. It's a curve, but it's causing pain in the church. Cut. Designs. Live by your design. But you cannot live by your design unless you have a revelation of yourself. Unless you learn how to cut and eliminate some things. Because some things, if they are not cut, they bring limitations in your life. Okay. One of the things, number three, I hope I will close whenever. One of the things that you must learn to do if you are to live by your design. Don't frustrate agitations to be attacks of the enemy. When David showed up in the battlefield, saints, he had the anger that other men did not have. The Bible says they've been there for 40 days, but nobody was angry enough to face Goliath. But when David came to the battlefield, remember, by now he's anointed. Because one of the things that frustrates a lot, saints, is when you have a king's anointing but doing shepherd's roles. It's when you have a king's anointing but you still bring people lunch. But when he gets there, he had the anger that others did not have. The reason you are angry when things do not move here, saints, it's not that you nearly anger issues. It's because you are shaped to correct things that are out of order in this house. There are some that will come in and go back without feeling anything. Even when there is something that says, give me a man, they will say, I am not the man. But the reason you feel agitated when something says, I need a man, and you are able to rise and stand, is because you are shaped for it. Ooh, maybe look at your neighbor and say, I'm shaped for it. I'm shaped for Restoration Center. I'm shaped to stand along Murutis Mono. I'm shaped for it. I am shaped for it. The reason I'm angry, I'm agitated when things are not going according to plan, is because I am shaped for it. That's the reason we've got people that are doing everything that needs to be done, because they are not comfortable to forever see Goliath say, give me a man. They are forever say, I am that man. And they come with armaments that do not look like they can face Goliath. Their trust is in the covenant they have with God. They say, Lord, you will help me do it. I might not have the skill for it, but I have God, the love to see myself becoming the missing puzzle in the house that I'm serving from. So, people that are angered in a setup like this are people who say, we refuse the status quo. And the feet must move from one level to the other. But we are not just going to focus on the conference. We are going to focus on the life of the church. Because the most powerful thing about church is not events. It's the life of the church. One of the frustrating thing about pastors or with pastors or that pastors go through. It's when I've got a powerful event, but I've got a weak church. So, can I jump some few things and we close? So, the next thing that you need to know if you are to live according to your shape is to have the ability to adjust. I like what you're doing. Can you see my shape? You must learn to adjust. We don't move. We are like Mount Zion. We are like God, the same yesterday, today, and forever. But if we are to move this church to the next level, we will need people that are flexible to adjust so that they can accommodate even things that we are not used to, but they are relevant for this season. Because one of the things that has killed many churches is when members are settling for a season, permanently so, and they refuse a new season coming through. We must learn to adjust. But you cannot adhere to adjust if you haven't find your shape. Because when you haven't find your shape, you're thinking, worry, when I adjust, I compromise the essence of my being. Let's close. Unwilling to adjust saying simply means that you are also failing yourself for the next level. Because some next levels of your life are hidden beyond you or behind you adjusting. If you don't adjust, you are disqualifying yourself from the next level. You'll be saying, it's coming my way. It's happening next year this time. Next month this time. It will not happen because it's waiting for you to adjust so that you can then feed into what God is doing in that season. And when you have broken the law, don't try to pray out the broken law. Fix it by obeying the law, and things will start to work. Let's close. Let's stand. If you don't stand, I will not close. Saints, when you find your shape, Murutismon, you start to have the appetites that you were not having before. You will even start to love things that you hated before. Because you have found your shape. The reason you don't have an appetite for other things is because you don't know your shape. You check who's got an appetite for what and you envy that and you copy that. Says, let me help you. You cannot copy grace. You can't copy favor. You can't copy shape. Amen. I was telling some of our members, Maruti Kere, onele vatoba ngwe bakangwala book ka ibala. Eke pechile yena na gwetla, I can tell you rasengwa le ke. Because ke tseba ka mogwanana. Ka mogwanana nka ona, he cannot write that. Because if you capitulate, you want to get about your tone and your language and your vocab. And once you write some things, I will automatically know, ah, here we copy something. We can say. So I'm saying to you, if you don't live by your design, you might be missing some interest and some appetites that you need to change your life for good. You will end up loving what people love and have interest of what people have got interest in and miss you. It's my prayer tonight that you will not miss your design. Amen.
Amen.
It's close, close. So, Masmo, until we have the courage to put off the armor of Saul, we will try to fight like Saul. And when we win, it's not us who won. It's Saul who won. But when we learn to put on what is in our design,
yes,
when we fight and win, we can look at God and say, thank you for making me in your own image. And I'm happy about it. When you knitted my being in the womb of my mother, I did not know that you were looking at this. Look at what I've become. I've become your design. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. My time is up. Close your eyes. My time is up. I don't know what is it that you have tried. But if it's not working, it's not working. It's not in your design. Go to God and say, Father, who am I? Why am I here? What's my purpose? What's my destiny? What's my shape? Because I want to navigate this life with the shape that you have in mind. We are sitting at the feet of Jesus this week, not just to have a great time, but to find a revelation of who we are, to find what is it that we must cut out of our lives, to find new appetites of what God will want us to pursue and start to embrace in our generation. When we combine this thing together and we start to work on them, saints, Restoration Center will become something that we never thought it could become. There is a lot that God has begun to do in this house, but until all of us embrace our shape and start to participate in everything that is happening in this house with the shape that God has ordained us to function in, something will break loose in this place. Pretoria will know that there is something good happening. Monel Mapias Restoration Center. I want you to lift up your hands and begin to pray tonight. I'm going to give you an opportunity to pray. I don't know what is it that the Lord spoke to you, but I want you to respond. When God speaks, somebody must respond. When God calls, somebody must answer. When God calls, somebody must say, yes, Lord. I want you to pray. I want you to pray. I want you to pray. Some of you, you will have to make a decision to cut some stuff in your life that frustrate the shape that God is trying to use in your life. No wonder you're not flowing the way you should flow in the giftings and the callings of God over your life, because you're missing the shape that God will want you to walk in. Can you lift up your voice, child of God? Can you lift up your voice and pray? Can you lift up your voice and pray? In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let us appreciate Bishop and clap hands for him and thank God for him. What a word. Wisdom was shared in this place. Bishop, may the Lord bless you. Each of us got a crumb. Cannot lever dia feta. Crumion. Each of us got one. Thank you very much, Bishop. I think we are about to close. I'm going to ask that they give us the offering baskets so that we can come and give. We do have a speed point. I think it's working today. As we give in a conference like this, give with the intention, yaori, so may the Lord bless you as you give. Amen. So we're going to come and give. God bless you. Ke hopela le re thuse. Ona le speed points as mo mola officing. Please help us quickly. We can come and give. God bless you.